As if you could spoil Lupin the Third. Understand. It's fun and cool. That's all there is to it. See for yourself. After all, I assume you're actually watching the video and not just browsing the internet on another tab, right? It's okay, I do it too. This is not about recommending you Lupin the Third. I'm going to be talking about it, assuming you're at least familiar with it. If you haven't already, there's plenty to choose from. And don't worry, if you want to watch Lupin the Third, you can start wherever you want. Every movie, special, and episode is completely self-contained. Well, most of it. But it's not a series you need to watch all of. Take it from someone who has. I really liked Lupin and wanted to watch all of it. So I did. 289 episodes and 41 movies. I went and watched all of it. All of it. No matter if it's trying to be gritty or story sacrifices romantic or strong,
we have no idea. It's not always
yes,
not me.
You also know how to use and it's actually the words.
Aliens?
Aliens, my guy!
Nothing is happening.
Way too much Lupin can be set anywhere in the world. Well,
it was a very beautiful place.
It's hard to place it.
I know he is an actor.
Nothing works
to get out of the
best.
I don't give a fuck.
It's Nazis again.
Yeah, I was recording something. I'm recording something. I'm sorry, making this a normal video essay is not working for me. I love this one, this one, this one, honestly this one, and especially fucking this one. And instead of telling you which ones to watch and which ones to avoid, I think digging into what makes a Lupin anime good, or rather, not good, is more constructive than just showing you my tier list. If I had to give this video a thesis, which is, you know, important, it would be, I regret watching all the Lupin anime because, despite the franchise's appeal, it reveals an assortment of patterns and choices that become detrimental to my enjoyment of future installments. So you're thinking, what is the franchise's appeal? They're celebrating Lupin's 50th anniversary on television this year, so I want the discussion in this video to remain relevant for whatever installments there are in the future. I want this to be less like a script and more fast and loose, because otherwise I'm going to lose more of my sanity, and I don't have much of sanity left to give fifth. So let's start with what I think is the most important factor to a movie or an episode of Lupin. No matter if it's trying to be gritty or goofy, romantic or raunchy, Lupin always needs to have spectacle. I bet you thought I was gonna say the characters. We'll get to them later. It's an action-adventure series, so it needs compelling action and you don't even need to feature all five characters. How do I know? This guy said it. This is Monkey Punch. He wrote the manga that I haven't read yet. yes, I do want to read it. I just haven't at this point. This is just about the anime. Please fuck off. I will read it. I want to read it. He said four things that I thought were important to bring up. First was that it wasn't until the anime version that having all five characters in it was a requirement. And I agree, but we're gonna put a pin in that. There's a pin. Second, he prefers chase scenes like Tom and Jerry over fight scenes. I almost cut that out of the script, but I just thought that was kind of a cool, good way to think about spectacle. It doesn't need to be a kung fu movie. I'm not demanding a kung fu movie, though I definitely wouldn't refuse it if you gave that to me. Lupin just needs shit to be happening, with minimal breaks in between. It sounds easy, but apparently it's not. That sounds like all I'm asking for is a dumb action movie, but it's more central to Lupin than you might think. When asked what the appeal of the series is, Monkey Punch said it was freedom. Lupin can do whatever he wants, wherever and whenever he wants, with no boundaries or borders. It was freedom. Freedom. This is the series where a character's defining trait is the ability to slice literally anything. That scene when Lupin's Fiat 500 climbs up the side of the cliff? Never fails to captivate me in the 40 times I've seen Cagliostro. Defying physics is also a form of freedom. You're also free from any continuity. And that's why there's so many different iterations of Lupin, because there's freedom to play it however you want. So if freedom is the main appeal, that means Lupin is difficult to get totally wrong. And that's why there's not so much Lupin anime that's bad exactly, but there's just so much of it that's mediocre and boring. If you've watched as much Lupin as I have, you might remember this feeling of sitting there watching like an episode for 10 minutes and then the eye catch plays, or you're in the middle of the 90-minute TV special, so that's 40 minutes, and you're just sitting there and you're thinking, my God, nothing has happened yet. Yeah, sure, things have technically happened, but you don't care. Why? Mediocre. Or as I affectionately call it, mid-pawn. Trying to describe mid-pawn is like trying to describe what something tastes like with saran wrap covering your trying to articulate all of that in a uniform and engrossing manner has been the bane of my existence all month. And I'm trying not to make that so frustrating to try and put mid-pawn into words, because the reason why it's mid-pawn seems intangible. So instead of trying to identify mid-pawn, I've found it much easier to identify how to avoid mid-pawn. Third, and I just thought this was funny, when he was asked what it was like to see his creation animated, he claimed to be no expert and said, when it comes down to it, I'm pretty much, well, make it good. No expert. My man Monkey Punch don't miss. It really is that easy. Just make it. Let's start with the obvious. Lupin deserves to be animated, directed, scored, and performed well. Thankfully, it's been blessed with a consistently great voice. I had a big fat paragraph on how Lupin needs to look good and sound good, but I really don't need both. It's got music composed by the legendary jazz musician Yuji Ono or Takeo Yamashita. Yes, he is a nice man. The series has, like, the most stacked pedigree an anime franchise could possibly ask for. You have Hayao Miyazaki, Osamu Dezaki, and almost Mamoru Oshii. He had a canceled Lupin movie that turned into Angel's Egg. There are obviously many more names than that, but I'm not going to database you as if you know most of them anyway. There's really only one Lupin anime I can point to that genuinely looks awful. Bottom line, that pedigree needs to be lived up to. You have all that freedom to make it look and sound really cool, but too much Lupin looks just okay. And that's not good enough. Koike has proven this to be possible in the modern day, Not that I want all Lupin to look like his designs, but they stand out more than the ever so slightly different designs of the TV specials, which is a glaring missed opportunity for a series that's free from such conformity. You can't do all these different styles with Doraemon or Detective Conan. How about something unique? Like this Lupin from the canceled Mamoru Oshii movie. It's different. It's interesting. Again, I had more to say about this, but that's basically it. I did, however, want to keep what I had to say about the music.
I've been dying to say this.
Just because you have music by legendary jazz musician Yuji Ono does not mean you also know how to use it. Much of the time, I don't even notice the music, or there isn't any music, or the music is placed awkwardly or cuts abruptly, or most often, it's the same 5 or 6 pieces of music over and over in every episode and special for decades. I love Fire Treasure as much as any Lupin fan. That does not mean you get to use it in other anime that's not Cagliostro to try to get me to care. The only thing I still remember from Missed by a Dollar was that it had better music than usual because it had a character who was a singer. She didn't add much to the story, but it didn't matter. She was more compelling than whatever the story was. I low-key want to use just music from that soundtrack because I'm sick of stressing over what music to put where. And if it's interesting music, I'm sick of it. But I'm having fun. I'm having fun just not giving a fuck. Okay, the next few points basically boil down to there's too much talking. Use the fucking setting. Supernatural bullshit sucks. Then we'll talk about the characters. And we'll finish off with basically the worst offender. It's the whole thing. And I'll keep that one just as a surprise because it's fun. The more Lupin you watch, the more each adventure feels disposable. Since each installment is self-contained with absolutely no continuity, it becomes increasingly difficult to get invested. Only a tiny handful of Lupin entries actually try to reward longtime viewers, and frankly, it's always just surface-level fan service at best. Like it's some flyer with Cagliostro's face on it or something. Like, who fucking cares, dude? That's why I think spectacle is the most important ingredient. Because it's irrelevant to how much Lupin you've seen. Cool shit is cool shit. That's why it's so important that things happen urgently and often. And I don't just mean have a hook for the audience. Too many Lupin anime have this exciting opening scene, but then lose all their momentum for whatever reason. Usually because it's just a lot of talking. Way too- I don't mind dialogue, obviously, but it's not like it's ever interesting dialogue. And if you can't manage that, it's still possible to make scenes like this memorable or interesting. Like, use some nice scenery or Kino music or something. But we're not here to watch characters stand around. They gotta be doing something, going somewhere. I don't mind when a Lupin anime tries to be more thought-provoking or emotional or political, but there's a purity that gets taken for granted if that conceptual stuff is all you put focus on. There's this really epic animator named Yasuo Ohtsuka. He was Hayao Miyazaki's mentor. He's one of the main reasons Lupin got animated to begin with. You know why? Because he wanted to draw cool guns and cars. That's why he wanted to animate Lupin. The very first episode of the TV series has these shots of like their watches, like Lupin and Jigen's watch trying to sync. And look how detailed and cool they look. Yeah, they're just watches, but think about somebody drawing and animating that.
But yeah, I'm so sorry for your loss.
Remember, Lupin is fun and cool. It seems kind of primitive, but what can I say? Lupin is kind of a monkey. Punch. Okay. Lupin can be set anywhere in the world, and the world is a very beautiful place, so it shouldn't be this hard to place him in a compelling set. It's getting hard for me to resist just easing back into the script I've polished and recorded so many times. Because I feel like this new approach sounds so much like a script anyway. I think I started noticing this as a problem when I was watching Part 2. Early episodes of Part 2 would start with a subtitle of where in the world this took place. And I liked that because it was like the setting mattered a little bit, you know? So much they wanted you to know where they were. And somewhere along the way, they just stopped doing that. If Lupin's in Paris, ask yourself, why Paris? I keep repolishing and rewording things in this script where it's not supposed to sound like a script because, like, I kept rewriting it because I was like, oh no, that wouldn't sound good. Like, I was doing that in this script where I'm not supposed to give a f-. But it's just so often that the setting just doesn't feel important in a Lupin anime. I think what compounds on this is when there's just a bunch of globetrotting and they're not even gonna stick to one location. It's especially bad when they actually have a really good location and they cut away. Look guys, this season takes place in France. It's much easier when I'm like recording things and I'm just like, just say it, just fucking say it. I'll probably keep that in too. At least part four made Italy seem really colorful and alive and rich. Like I was happy that it was all in Italy, kind of. It had a feel to it. And that's another thing. Of course the settings don't even look that good either. Fucking Fuma Clan takes place in this Japanese mountain village in the middle of fall. This shit's gorgeous. And Mystery of Mamo has the same kind of weak setting where it kind of bounces all over the place and has a lot of different settings, but at least it consistently looks cool, right? Since it's often the Lupin gang's first time being there, that's all the more reason for them, and thereby the audience, to be given a moment to take in their surroundings. Let us follow them down into this cave system. Show us them exploring the castle. I feel so fucking free doing this, man. I'm feeling so much better. I didn't want this to be about which ones to watch or not watch. That's basically what this video does perfectly fine, which I gotta be honest has put a lot of stress on me just knowing it exists and me making my video. No disrespect to the creator at all. It's a good video. I just don't want to invite any comparisons. There's something that I can never unsee about Lupin settings. Is how often Lupin and the gang rent out a generic hotel room, like with a couch and the whatever, man. There's nothing distinctive about them. Like, if you're gonna rent out a place, why don't you make it like a little more interesting than this? They all look the same. Case in point, you could do this thing that Blood Seal did with this basement bar. Like, it doesn't have anything to do with the plot, but it helps it stand out. It's something kind of interesting and different. One of Miyazaki's part two episodes, 145, opens on this camper van, but it has so much shit in it, like a lot of trash and their food and clothes hanging all over the place. Like, it feels really lived in and distinct. And even like a few minutes later, they're on this like little houseboat. Look how much like different details in there and like how much crap is on Lupin's desk. Like, you'd think like that doesn't seem very refreshing, but like compared to the nothing, just nothing in these other Lupin settings, it's very refreshing. The big skyscraper in Nostradamus with the fucking ski resort inside of it is ridiculously awesome. Why are you cutting away from that and sending half the movie in the jungle? The thing is, right, I don't want to embarrass myself. I don't want to disappoint people who love what I make, and usually what I make is very succinct and polished and, you know, typical, I guess. I don't know. There is a part five episode that takes place basically in one room, and yeah, even that is more interesting than a lot of these, like, epic, we're bouncing all over the globe, man. Like, that's totally different and not what I would expect. And it's interesting in that way.
That coochie's a blood-sucking bitch.
What in the hell is the matter with you guys?
I don't want to regret making a video like this where it's, you know, it's like, oh, that's kind of cringe that he didn't give a fuck or whatever. But like, I'm having fun doing this right now. I feel so much better. Okay, this next point irritates me so much. I'm not spending more than 30 seconds on this point. Ready? Go. Supernatural crap like time travel, gremlins, and fucking aliens undercuts all the other times when Lupin has weird shit but with a cheeky explanation. Some of it is fun, like the popcorn rocket, new type girl, and magic blood, but I think there's a line where it gets too absurd and it makes me check out. Like, I get they're already superhumans and it's not supposed to be realistic, but there's a limit before it comes off really dumb. It makes me think all the freedom this series already allows you isn't enough for you. You could do anything with this concept and they're spending that time on this bullshit? Fuck off. That felt really good. Okay, to make up for that, I'm gonna stop acting like a dum-dum and I'm going to just include this paragraph from my previous script. I actually want to keep this one because I think it's kind of Kino with the music and things like that. So, consider the pin removed. I've wrestled with how to talk about this a lot. It's why I haven't really mentioned them until now, when that's usually, like, the first thing people talk about. The main cast is what makes this series so enduring, and worth coming back to each and every time, no matter how boring it's gonna turn out to be. Each of these characters have so much style, charisma, wit, and heart. They mean a lot to a lot of people, and everyone has their favorite. I don't want to enforce my preferences onto them. How best to portray them? I don't like when Fujiko portrays Lupin, but that's so core to her character, who am I to discourage it? I prefer when Zenigata has this whole crew of loyal police officers who follow his every command, but that's pretty rare and not necessary for making him work. But the thing I've zeroed in on that I don't like, when it happens to any of them, no matter what era or style Lupin is when the characters are disrespected. They can have weaknesses, make bad decisions, be the flawed characters that they are, but don't shaft them. If they're put in situations they're stuck in the whole time, it's a waste of their character. If you pretend to kill Lupin off, and he stays dead for a long time, that's all that time you aren't spending with Lupin doing cool stuff. If Goemon doesn't have his Zantetsukin, or it's broken or something, you're defanging him. Give him a challenge to overcome that doesn't require nerfing him. If Fujiko is being objectified or held hostage, I expect her to at least look like she's actually in control, and will get out of it herself like the badass she is. Zenigata is the butt of a lot of jokes. He's the Tom to Lupin's Jerry. But he's also a really capable, smart, compassionate, and determined character. If you don't know how to incorporate Zenigata into this story, and way too many Lupin anime don't, I'd rather you don't have him there at all than have him wandering around like a clueless idiot. And as for Jigen, what comes to my mind is all those times he says he quits and leaves the mission, only to always swoop back in later on. I like it as a dramatic device, but it's happened so often now, it's become too predictable. So all you're doing is just like killing off Lupin. You're removing Jigen from the story for a payoff that's lost all of its impact. So all it amounts to is less screen time. Their balance of screen time is the trickiest part about all of this. On one hand, it sucks when Jigen and Goemon don't show up for most of the movie, but I've seen it work often enough that I ultimately don't mind it so long as we know where they are in the story. If they aren't key players this time around, just give them something cool to do. Fujiko is barely in Goemon's blood spray, but one of the only shots of her in that movie is the single coolest iconic image of her to date. That's why I emphasized spectacle over the characters at the beginning, even though they're actually more integral to Lupin. Without spectacle, they have nothing cool to do, and all you have is them standing around. It's mid-pawn. And one more. Ready? Go. You obviously can't kill Lupin or any of the main five. If you could, then we would have gotten that fucked up Mamoru Oshii movie. I'm sorry, but it's a hard rule. Don't bother trying to trick us. It's a waste of time. Sure, put them in danger. Heck, go ahead and fake out kill any of the other characters, because it's not like they have plot armor like Lupin. But if you pretend any of the main five are dead for more than a minute, I will never believe you, and I'll just get impatient waiting for them to come back. We know he isn't actually dead. Please move on. I want to bring you into this headspace I was in during this marathon. I liken it to watching all of the James Bond movies. What do you expect when watching a Bond movie? You may have heard of the Bond villain, the Bond girl, or you might think of the gadgets, the dangerous henchmen, the car, all the exotic or treacherous places he'll go, and even the differences in who is playing 007. Most of the movies have predictable features, just like Lupin the Third. Except the only real predictable features in Lupin should be the five core cast members. There seems to be a very noticeable appeal for Lupin fans when it comes to what colored jacket Lupin is wearing. Except, it doesn't really make much of a difference. Having actually watched all of them, I think it's kind of bullshit to make a big deal out of it. Lupin wears a black jacket in Goodbye Partner,
but it's really not that much different from the rest of the franchise. He wears mostly a tan jacket in Twilight Gemini, but he's still Lupin. Pink Jacket is this infamous, really wacky Lupin, but it's not even all that silly and wacky. Actually, aside from one or two episodes, it only looks silly more than it actually acts it. I mean, geez, there are several part two episodes that are way goofier.
I've got to do something. He's getting worse.
What is Lupin wearing a green jacket supposed to mean? Is he more mature like Cagliostro? Or new to the scene like Fujiko Mine? What about Fuma Clan? Somewhere in the middle? It just doesn't matter. The TV specials in particular took the most popular Lupin entry to this day, Castle of Cagliostro, and turned the things in that movie into other predictable features, like the Bond movies. There's almost always a quote-unquote Lupin girl, or kid that tags along, a MacGuffin treasure that Lupin has in order to find an even greater treasure, and most often you could identify a singular Lupin villain that they must defeat. None of those are necessary staples. They're part of a template. I know this because the other Lupin before Cagliostro didn't have this. Part 1 and 2, and Mystery of Mamo, not even Part 3 or Fuma Clan afterwards. The TV movies are what made it a formula. Look, it's simply not fair to expect complete originality with every Lupin installment. Even Cagliostro shares a number of deja vu moments from Part 1. The fact that there's patterns at all is a problem. This rote, formulaic pattern seems pretty antithetical to the core appeal of doing whatever you want, right? It works for Bond because he's a government agent, his missions are formulaic by nature, and he has no choice to accept that. But Lupin is a thief! His life should not be this predictable! The TV series does shake this up a lot more, but there's definitely still trends and patterns to be found there too. A lot of these pet peeves I've been talking about become pet peeves from happening not once or twice, but over and over and over. This is the most pervasive fault of the franchise. It's Nazis again! She's someone from Jigen's past again! Goemon fights a helicopter again! The word again itself is Midpon. The good news is, because so much Lupin has played to this formula, there's still plenty of uncharted territory left. But if you're going to use the same tricks, it better be worth it. Or you're going to lose me. I think I've had much more fun, and I'm at peace with this recording. And I still love how I originally was going to end this video, so I'm going to keep it as it is, because it's pretty Kino. Thank you for sticking with me with this really different kind of video. There was a Matthew Matosas video recently where he talked about the growing insurmountable challenge of game criticism, in which people born in 2020 will not be able to catch up on all the titles considered to be classics. And while I don't consider myself to be a critic, I couldn't help but relate to the sentiment when it comes to anime. When you get as involved and passionate as I have, you get the desire to watch everything. You see these user lists with over 1,000 anime, and want to reach that point yourself. But it's becoming impossible to just keep up with what's coming out every 3 months, never mind all the decades of anime that have come before. That desire to watch everything, it's okay. I still feel that way. But I regret that it led me to watch all of the Lupin anime, because it's pretty much made me jaded to the whole thing. It's fortunate that this didn't burn me out completely, and I actually do look forward to Lupin's next adventure, just with a very weary dose of skepticism. I still love the entries that I love, and will stick to rewatching and recommending those. In fact, I made this alongside Steven's video on my first and still favorite entry, Castle of
To this day!
I'm glad my curiosity got the better of me this time. I probably won't be as much of a completionist with other anime franchises anymore, though I still want to at least sample them all. If you still love Lupin and wish to watch all of it one day, like I did, I can't stop you. All I can say is, maybe you don't have to. Oh.
Thank you very much to my patrons, including Aochi, Austin, Beyond Ghibli, Boo, Beamburst, Cake, Cam, Cozy, El Poserino, Flugmorph, Hazel, Irvon, Jackson, Joji, Kuiper, Lord God, My Anime Pod, Najbeb, Plufinvigent, Vrika Fag, Saxon, Seaweed Ambassador, Tengun, Unique Namosaurus, Ventu, Victor, and Yellow Cheese. That is so many names. Thank you so much. I love you all. And a special thanks to Steve-em for putting up with my bullshit. Thanks. I'll see you again.